Our campsite outside of Atlanta. We are hanging out at Sawney Corps of Engineers Campground because once a year we get to go to Atlanta to go to a doctor's appointment. And so for us, camping is by far cheaper than staying in a hotel. So if I have to travel for a doctor's appointment, I don't really want to pay $140 a night to stay in a hotel. We're going to stay in a campground. So I thought about what we would talk tonight and kind of realized if I was coming to you live from a campground that we may end up kind of ending up hijacking whatever other topic I came with to talk camping. We might as well just make travel and camping our topic. So hopefully it's going to work great for us. We have actually amazing internet at this campground. You may see, you know, an occasional fly and fun things jump in because we're camping. This is just life. But that is our goal tonight, is to talk just tips and tricks to save money when you're camping, when you're traveling in general. So you may not be a camping person. That's okay. But we can also go wherever your questions take us. So if you want to talk CVS, Target, I'm okay with that. We will just go wherever y'all want to go. But we'll start with just some budget travel tips. And as Sue's asking, our camper does have air conditioning. Thankfully, I actually debated making all the kids stay up late so that I could just come live from inside the camper. But my husband, he vetoed me and said they had to go to bed and I could be outside. So we're good. But as we jump in to camping, I do want to share just some things that we've learned through the years on ways to find some discounted campsites. And one of them being the fact that I am not in a Georgia State Park. I'm not really in a national park. We're at an Army Corps of Engineer campground. So if you've not discovered some of the alternate places to camp, it's considerably cheaper than state parks. And I know that's hard to imagine because state parks are pretty cheap, but Army Corps of Engineer parks, even cheaper. So this is actually through recreation.gov. If you've not looked into it, you should. And we're currently, so the park that we're at is at Lake Lanier and the Buford Dam, which is an Army Corps of Engineers electrical dam that is off of Lake Lanier. And they actually own a chunk of the shoreline, possibly the whole shoreline, I'm not quite sure. And there's a number of parks all around it. So anyone that's in the Atlanta area, y'all are missing out if you haven't been up here. But to camp here, we have a full electric water hookup. We don't have sewer, but electric and water hookup for like $20 to $25 a night during peak season. That's pretty crazy. If you are a senior, which is 62 or older, you can get a senior pass to Army Corps of Engineer sites, and you will pay a whopping $6 to $12 a night to spend the night. I have a little while till I hit that, but I'm like counting it down. When can we start to get those discounts? But even at $25 a night for a full electric and water hookup, that's a crazy good price. So recreation.gov allows you to search national park sites, but it also includes Army Corps of Engineers sites too. And I was kind of researching it, there's over 450 Army Corps of Engineers sites across the country, and most of them are on lakes because most of them are related to this electrical and dam system that the Army Corps of Engineers runs. One thing I did read in terms of reviews, and my husband and I would completely agree, these are some of the most level and precise sites we've ever been at, because the review was saying they're built by engineers. I would agree. I mean, we didn't have to do a thing to level our camper. And if you're camping, folks, you learn quickly, like you're getting creative. You're getting up on blocks of wood and whatever it takes to level out. Just pulled in, parked, and we were done. So you got to check them out if you haven't already checked out Army Corps of Engineer sites. And if you aren't a camper, most of them still have day things to do as well. So maybe we're just adding something that's local to you that could be a getaway for the day. Head over and find a neat park to check out. So again, you go to recreation.gov and you can find those. State parks are great too. And we stay state parks all the time. But this is just another place to look, which honestly, this summer, if you are a camper, you may have already realized this summer to find a campsite is incredibly hard. You won't find one during the weekend in most state parks, so you're gonna have to get creative. South Carolina, I feel like every state park in South Carolina is completely booked for every weekend. So you're gonna have to get either camp during the weekdays or find somewhere else to camp. So for us, again, if you jumped in the beginning, I kind of shared we're outside of Atlanta. And the reason once a year we go to Atlanta for a doctor's appointment, and for us, it is cheaper to camp than to get a hotel room. So the whole family gets to come along. We get to have a little vacation and we get to have a doctor's appointment and we get to go home. So if you have, you know, followed Southern Tapers for a really long time, I have a kiddo that was diagnosed about 5 years ago with a hip disease. And so we have been followed by Atlanta Children's and a pediatric hip specialist that is there for the last 5 years. She had a great checkup, but it's a long process and we get to continue coming back for checkups. Someday he'll tell us we don't have to, but we'll get to camp again, the next time, and that's okay. So, as we jump in, my husband's trying to get folks in bed too. So I'm going to get to questions in a minute and try to catch up as well. I know there's a lot, and I am fine with off topic. I see Karen's really quick on Ibotta, and Ibotta now has direct deposit. Yes, Karen, I would say go for it. So Saving Star has offered direct deposit for years. Saving Star, it used to be owned by Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, who is owned by the U.S. government. Ibotta now offers that direct to your bank. Go for it. Ibotta's huge. They're not really going to mess with that system. Now you don't have to get it cash out through PayPal or through gift cards. Just send it right back to the bank, which is perfect. So I would do it in a heartbeat. If you're to that cash out point with Ibotta, just get it set up and be done with it. And others, if you're using other apps like Kroger, allows you to do cashback through the Kroger cashback system. I got a lot of questions on that from the Kroger live video that I did this past week. And so Kroger cashback, you can actually send all of your earnings to your Kroger card to come off the next time you're in Kroger, which is also pretty sweet. So Ibotta doesn't have that ability to come off the next time you're in the store. This is basically the next best thing to go right back in to your checking account. You know, do it and have that money back. Okay, let's talk really quick. I saw one person's comment was, I want a camper. And so I kind of wanted to go there for anyone that's in that boat, because camping is really big right now. It's something that you can do. You can be completely socially distant. There's nobody in the background. Yes, there are other people in the park, but folks are just hanging in their own campsite. And so you got out of the house and you got to go somewhere different and see some different trees and different scenery. So if you're curious as to how to get a camper, I will just tell you, ours isn't that super special. I wish I could turn my camera around because I'm having to use the light from the camper tonight. But ours is a whopping 15 years old. We bought it 3 years ago, so very used, but that's okay. And when you're looking at campers, they hold their value. That's the one thing I really wanted to emphasize. So what we paid for our camper 3 years ago is still what it's worth today. If we turned around and we said, you know what, we're really not using this, we could get every dollar back. Now, we have had to do some repairs because when we bought it, we got a really great price on it and it needed those repairs. My husband he can kind of handle anything that you throw at him or YouTube can teach him kind of guy. And so he did do some leak repairs, because you'll hear this as soon as you start to hunt for a camper. There are two types of campers, those that do leak and those that will leak someday. So ours already had some water damage and he had to kind of rip off the whole front side and replace it. But we knew that going in, and that's really the only work that it's had to have. But that's also a 15-year-old camper when we bought it, so not bad. And again, they do hold their value. So I did want to show you one site. If you're looking at campers, it's honestly my same advice that I would give you for a car. Never buy new. Just like cars, campers lose their values the second you drive them off the lot. So sorry if you own Camping World, it isn't a deal. To buy a brand new camper is not a deal. There are a ton of folks who will buy a camper, my father is one of them, will buy a camper, use it for 3 years, and then decide, there's some feature I don't like about it, and they'll go get another one. I've never understood this about my own father, but those folks, those are the people that you want to buy a camper from, because they've dealt with all of the price drop for you. And now you're going to get a really great price 3+ years later, or like us, 15+ years later. So there is a website that I would recommend for you. And to pull it up, I actually went and pulled up all of our details to show you what this looks like. So this is the NADAGuides.com. And really, if you just kind of Google Blue Book for campers, you will find it. But the NADA Guides, NADAGuides.com/RV, You can put in the year, you can put in the model, you can also just put in what you're looking for. It will find that too. But for us, this is ours. We have a 2004 Jayco. It's a bunkhouse series, which means it can fit seven people because there's a lot of us. New, it would have been a whopping almost $18,000. Average retail, $5,360. So for ours, we paid a few years back the exact same price that we could, really less than we could end up getting it for today. And it's had repairs, so probably could get it even better. And it will let you also plug in if it's had, and I didn't, I just took the base model, but you can sit here and plug in options. You can kind of totally tailor that to what you're looking for. So if you've bought a used car before and you're used to being able to pull up Blue Book, you can do the same thing for campers. So if you're kind of curious and you just want to go hunting, some places to look. Facebook Marketplace is great. That's actually how we found ours, Facebook Marketplace. You can also look on Craigslist. You can look in the classifieds. People still post campers in the classifieds. You can go through Camping World and some of those places. Just make sure that you've done your research as to what that camper is worth. Because once I go retail, it's going to be just like I went retail with a car. And you are going to have a higher price than if you bought directly from an owner. So, you know, anytime we're looking at buying a used car, we typically get a better deal if we go from the owner than if we bought from a car dealership. Now, there are pros and cons to both. Car dealership, you know, a lot of times you feel a little safer. You feel like you've got maybe some fallback if there are some problems. Keep in mind with older campers, no one's going to give you a warranty that it doesn't have issues. They may say, you know, we've given it this kind of inspection, but you can give it that inspection yourself. You know, you're not really going to end up with a warranty because of their inspection unless it's a much, much newer camper. So if you're in our boat and you're looking for that 15-year-old camper that you can pay for, you know, with your tax refund or whatever it might be, you're not going to have any magical warranties on that super old camper, but you're going to hopefully get a great deal. You just need to know kind of going in what you're getting. Now, if you aren't to camper mode and you just want to go with a tent, we see some crazy good deals for tents starting in August. So we're almost there, like 2 weeks out, and all of our summer gear is going to go on clearance. So if you're thinking, you know, I don't know if we want to camp now, but grab a tent and try it out. And we're talking super great deals. So, you know, 5 and 6 person tents, which does not mean it holds 5 and 6 people. We always joke that you should just cut that in half. The 6 person tent's really a 3 person tent, but still as cheap as like $40 or $50. So super cheap prices once they go on clearance for tents. So you don't have to go fancy. You don't have to have the air conditioning, though it is pretty nice in the South. But you can get some great prices on clearance summer gear. If you guys haven't already seen it, you know, not even talking camping, but Home Depot and Lowe's, all of their patio stuff, Target, all the patio stuff, up to 50% off now. I was in Home Depot earlier today because we do have a part that's broken. Every time we go camping, something little breaks. So I ran by Home Depot on our way home from the doctor's office and grabbed a little valve or whatever. My husband sent me exactly what to get. And, you know, taking advantage of that, getting that at Home Depot. But while I was in there, 50% off, all patio. So we're there. Like, summer's on clearance, guys, and tents fall into that. So you can camp all fall and have a great time. Fall's actually the ideal time to camp, fall and spring, because it's not super, super crazy hot, even in the South. And you can have a blast. So off topic, Tracy's question, CVS Care Pass, can I explain it and is it good? It's totally good, Tracy. If you are a regular CVSer or pondering being a regular CVSer, CVS Care Pass, you pay $5 a month and they give you 10 in rewards. Yeah, it's pretty awesome. You also get free shipping on most products, free 2-day shipping on most products. And a $10 reward every month. You also get free delivery with meds, but that depends on where you live. So for me, they aren't delivering them. I know someone else was sharing that they live 7 miles from a CVS and CVS isn't delivering it for them either. So maybe or not, maybe not on the prescriptions, but free 2-day shipping and that $10 reward totally pays for itself because you paid $5 and you doubled your money. So you should do CVS Care Pass. Sign up in the store. You can sign up online, but sign up in your store because your store gets a little perk for every person that they get registered for CarePass. Okay, Wendy wants to talk back to school supplies, and that's actually what I thought we might talk today, Wendy, but I didn't know if I was outside and said I was camping, whether we would end up just talking. I didn't know. But for back to school, we're seeing deals on Target, Staples every week. They're posting deals. Those deals aren't changing a ton, though this week, if anyone needs a graphing calculator, there is a very good deal on graphing calculators. Staples has them for like the color graphing for $99 and the not color graphing for $88. If you don't care about Staples though, don't forget that Target will price match Staples. So I could just head in with that Target, with that Staples ad, get it at Target, pay with my red card, and get an even better price. We have not seen computers go super cheap yet, and I'm kind of pondering where computer prices are going to go, whether or not we're going to see them as cheap as we saw last year. I've been reading a lot of, like, just going behind the scenes and digging news articles on computers, and most of the computer companies are saying that they've seen the biggest peak on laptop, like, demand this entire spring with so many people working from home. And so I'm not sure what we're going to see computer-wise. We've seen some decent sales, but nowhere as low as we've seen in years past for back-to-school season. So, you know, you can jump on it if you want. I may, you know, push all of you to my favorite site for computers, and that's Refurbished. So it's DellRefurbished.com, and they regularly run coupon codes of up to like 35 or 40% off, and it makes for some super cheap Dell laptops. That might be your best option this year. We'll just see. But there have been a couple, just none that have been amazing computer-wise. But Target and Staples, all of the grocery stores have turned on their back-to-school deals as well. Those deals, grocery store-wise, do not change. So the sales that we have at Kroger, at Publix, any other grocery stores, they will stay exactly the same prices through mid-September. No changes. And Publix, guys, literally, I keep these in a spreadsheet. I pulled up Publix's sale from last year. Exact same products, exact same prices, down to the penny for Publix, and no change, no additional products. So that's how predictable grocery store sales are. I try to tell you guys, every 6 weeks we see the same. They're incredibly predictable every summer, same back to school supplies. So same for Kroger. They're already turned on. Kroger deals run through the 15th of September, I'm pretty sure, and we'll see the same at most grocery stores. So that's what we're seeing so far. What I would recommend really is watching Target and Staples for what they're putting on sale each week, taking advantage of those sales or price matching those sales between the two of them, and then grabbing the things that you need. Maybe beyond that, other places. One fun thing to remember, Staples is offering free shipping on any order right now, so you don't actually even have to go to Staples. You can get your 50-cent crayons from home. And Target, if you've got a red card, you're not going to pay shipping there either. So both places, you can do all of your school shopping without leaving the house. So just kind of a, you know, throw that out there. If you're not wanting to go to the store, you can still get some great prices. Santorio, do I ever coupon in Goodnight's pull-ups? So I never had to use the Goodnight's, but we still see great deals on them. Normally going to be the drug stores. So whenever we see Huggies and pull-ups on sale, Goodnight's is typically included in that. The same coupons are out. When you go to Huggies.com, you can print those coupons for Goodnight's. We don't see as great of offers. So there aren't usually Ibotta offers or other things to plug in with Goodnight's because it's a much smaller proportion that's dropped off. But there are still deals on them. Reward deals, particularly in the drugstores, and still put some printable coupons that you could use. So that's where I would point you for the best deals that are out there. Okay, so let's go back and just talk a little bit more on budget travel, and then we can go again wherever you want. Sally, I agree. Sally says, I wish the campgrounds around me weren't full. Most of them are. So you know what? One thing to think about, if you're working from home, you can work from a campsite just as well as you can work from home. And they aren't full during the week. So a few weeks back, we actually went camping at a state park, but I could still completely post deals for you guys and share them from my chair sitting at the campsite. So that you don't have to be sitting at home to work. Maybe you do. It depends on what you do. You know, no, probably no Zoom meetings live from the campsite. I don't know how well they'd love that. But if you're just kind of doing your own thing, then go during the week. So for us, that camping trip that we did a few weeks back was a Tuesday to Friday because, yeah, every campsite is slammed Friday, Saturday, Sunday. But we were out on Friday morning, and it wasn't a problem. So it's one thing to consider anyway. Okay. Oh, and my mom just sent me a note, Santora. So if you are looking for deals on good nights, there's actually a good night Ibotta offer right now. She's just sent me a Slack message because she always tends to watch that she was importing it right now into the database. So there are offers in Ibotta, and I take it back. Go mom for keeping me current on all the things that are there. Okay, let's see. So to check, kind of checking back in. Oh, and Jill says she just got back from Lake Altoona. I guess we were just talking about that one. My husband was going through trying to ponder the other lakes that are in the Georgia area. Yeah, and if you haven't checked out recreation.gov, that's what I was mentioning in the beginning and how we find these sites. It is super easy to even put in filters and find exactly what you're looking for, and super cheap campsites that aren't always full because not everybody really realizes that they're out there. Now, one question that I get sometimes from folks just when they are asking me and I'm sharing camping is, do we stay in private campgrounds? Yes and no. We have done a couple private campgrounds. However, they are not nearly as cheap as recreation.gov or even state parks. So one example near here for Atlanta folks is Stone Mountain. We love Stone Mountain. We did stay there a few years back for a doctor's appointment visit. But you're talking about almost three times the price for a campsite. It did have sewer, but now we're so used to not having sewer hookups that I don't really think it's worth that much money if you can get a campsite somewhere else. Sorry, Stone Mountain. We love Stone Mountain, but when it comes down to saving money, private campgrounds are not always the way to go. There are some ways to save on them. So if you are wanting to do a ton of camping, then it may pay for you to get a Good Sam's membership, Good Sam Club, which is through Camping World. So Camping World owns Good Sam's Club, or Good Sam's Club owns Camping World. I don't know which way it went first. But getting that membership does give you a discount at Good Sam Parks all over the country, which are private campsites, and it gives you a discount at Camping World. We had this the first year that we were camping. We have not had that discount since, and for us, we don't tend to stay private, and we tend to, if something breaks on the camper, we just get the part from Home Depot or we order it from Amazon, but we don't usually end up running to Camping World for it. There may be something that you need that, you know what, Camping World really does have the best price. If the membership's going to pay for itself because of something you have to have, then get the membership. But if it's not, you know, I don't know. They do run regular discounts, though. So if you've never had a Good Sam membership, head into Camping World. And a lot of times, the first time you get a membership, they offer you basically the full value of the membership back in credit for things from Camping World. So that can totally pay off. For a first-time membership, you just want to head in and see what they're offering in the store for new memberships, or play the game, let your old membership lapse for a while and be a new membership again. But usually they're going to need at least 6 months, sometimes longer, before you're allowed to re-sign up. You could also play the game and sign up a spouse instead of yourself, you know, whatever it takes. But do it in the store and take advantage of whatever the certificates are. That's how it'll be. They'll say, oh, you pay $45 for membership and you get back $40 in certificates in Camping World gear. Well, great. If you needed things anyway, that just made the membership cost $5. And that can open up a number of camp sites to you at a discount. Not a huge discount, but something. AAA also is available for private campgrounds, and there are discounts there. If you are considered a senior, there are definitely senior discounts at all campgrounds. You know, for us, we have a little while till we get to qualify for that. So we just tend to stay recreation.gov, so National and Army Corps of Engineer sites, and state parks, just so that we can get the best price on campsites. And generally that price is the same whether it's a tent or an RV site in those campgrounds, just to keep that in mind. Some of them do offer tent sites cheaper. So if you have a tent, look for tent sites. Definitely if they're going to offer a discount, because you're going to pay for an RV site possibly a little bit more, and you're still going to have water and electricity at a tent site in most cases, but not have to pay quite as much because it doesn't take a tent site's not as big. A tent site is smaller, so it takes up less real estate. A lot of places will charge less for them. Okay. And Rose says they went camping at the beach except for bugs and crowds. It was great. You know what? if we could solve bugs, I think even my 15-year-olds would do this all the time. But we have one in particular who we just drag with us every time we go. And Rose is saying that they bought a 20-year-old Mini Winnie last year and updated the interior only. So buy a used RV, and if you like it, before you invest a ton of money. Yes. Buy a used RV 100% of the time. Interestingly, though, if you are on the fence, and I don't know where to point you to here, but the folks that were directly behind us in this campground, they left this morning, they were renting their RV by the night from a campground or from an RV dealer. So, if you're on the fence and you don't even know if RV life is where you want to go, that could be an option for you. They went to an RV dealer in the area. Their RV literally had stickers on it, and we were kind of thinking like, okay, obviously you want people to know your RV is new. You just left the stickers on it. No, they left the stickers on it because they were just renting it. And maybe now we feel a little bad for commenting on their stickers still on their camper. But it's a great way to try out camping life, see if camp life works for you without having to put all of the money behind it. We had previously done that. Now, way long ago, we didn't have any kids. We rented a RV in Alaska. This was eons ago, dream trip before you have kids. It was kind of our last trip before kids. And with that rental, you can just pay like $100 and an extra $100, but the RV came with everything you needed, plates, sheets, everything. I mean, we were flying in from South Carolina to Alaska. And again, this was like 16 years ago, so I don't know if it's still that price, but it was a great way for us to experience RV life, also to realize what we didn't know about our RV life, and get to experience Alaska too at a discount versus having to pay for hotel rooms or cabins as we traveled the interior. So their rentals are out there. You don't actually have to go buy an RV if you want to experience camping life, and it can be a great way to figure out what you're looking for in a camper, what you need or what you don't need. Maybe it would have saved my dad years of trading in campers looking for the model that he wanted. Maybe he should have just rented all those years, but it is an option before you just start throwing out money, just to realize, oh, we didn't need this feature and this feature. One other thing to look at, so if we really are going to talk campers here for a bit, is how much can your vehicle pull? And don't mess that up, because you will really, really regret it. So it is in your vehicle user's manual. You can Google it, what your vehicle can pull, and understanding what camper dry weight is versus heavyweight, which means like loaded down. It's got all your stuff in it. And you might as well just take that loaded down weight, because you are not carrying a dry camper. You are carrying a loaded camper. And I don't mean like, you're carrying water. You may if you are boondocking. We have never attempted that, but you can. That means that you are going out where there is no power and there is no water, and you are going to bring in your own water. That's extra weight. So if you're in that mode, you're definitely going to be at that heavy part. But you need to see what your vehicle can tow before you go off getting a heavy, heavy camper. So for example, our camper is super old, but it does not have any slides. And back in 2004, when our camper was made, they did have slides. But for us to be able to haul a camper with slides, that adds so much weight to the camper that it is above the towing weight of our Toyota Sequoia. So we have 7 people. We can't tow with a truck because we can't fit in a truck. We're kind of limited to what we can tow with. So you need to be mindful of that too before you dive into too much camper. Don't really need a ton of it. We are not necessarily sit inside the camper all day long, folks. We're go inside the camper when it's bedtime or when it's raining, but we tend to sit outside all the rest of the time, or hang outside and do things in the park versus sitting in the camper the whole time. Let's see. So Deb, I see your question. She says, I'm missing something. All I can find to add my rewards is for charities. Where do I put in my bottle cap number? So are you talking about like Coke rewards, Deb? In terms of Coke rewards, if that's the way you're going, we can try to dig in there. I haven't used their site in eons since they got rid of actual decent Coke rewards. For me, I just kind of let it slide at that point. But I do know a lot of what they have gone to is using an app. So you may want to try making sure that you're using not their website, but see if you can use their app and see if they've streamlined the process of rewards a little bit more for the mobile side versus the desktop side. And Rose is also saying that hers is a 2004 camper, and they paid a lot less finding it on eBay, drove to West Virginia, and it was totally worth it. They had to replace the AC after a year, and her husband and YouTube helped. So it does help to have a handy husband, and YouTube is by far the way to learn everything that you need to learn. So 2004 is just a magical year for campers, Rose. I would agree. We drove about 2.5 hours to find ours. So if you are looking for a used camper, I would extend your search to where you're willing to go look, and realize that used campers, while I'm telling you we could get back everything we bought it for, it's kind of a hot market. So when we were looking at ours, there was a whole other couple coming up. One couple was there looking at it when we got there. Another couple came up while we were looking at it to also look at the same camper. And so you need to be ready to make some decisions for some of these campers. Definitely if it's a good used camper and you can tell that it was well taken care of. So don't go in and think you're going to get to sit and wait on it. It's kind of like the real estate market right now with folks that are putting their house on the market and having offers within like 24 hours and multiples of them. It's the same for someone who's trying to sell a used camper, because camping is huge right now. People can't go international traveling. They are U.S. traveling. So road trips are in, and camping is definitely in. Not saying that you shouldn't buy a camper, just realize that it's a good market for a seller. So you could find some great deals for folks that have thought, you know what, we're not really using this anymore. It's a great time to sell it. But it is a seller's market. So you're going to need to make decisions quickly and not just, you know, think it's going to be there for a while. Head up, look at it, and kind of move on. Or head up and grab it if you think it's the one you want. And Kathy, I love this. Kathy says she bought a 2010 RV in 2017 and sold it in February for the exact same price. So yeah, old campers, it's a pretty good investment. You get to enjoy the fun of it, hopefully, if you take care of it. You get to enjoy the fun of it and then basically get your money back in the end. And all you paid for was campsites for all the years that you owned it. That's the goal, right? So Marilyn asks, what's the cost to rent a motorhome to travel to Wyoming instead of flying? So there are some things to consider, Marilyn, when it comes to motorhomes. It's a lot like renting a car, and you'll want to make sure that you can find a motorhome. Like, is mileage included or is mileage not included? You're going to need to do some hunting, but your goal would be to pay for a motorhome and to have mileage included and only be paying by the day. So it didn't matter how far you took it, didn't matter where you took it, I'm just gonna pay for the day. If you're trying to go super far and come back, that's ideal. So if you're gonna bring the motorhome back, then that's gonna be even cheaper for you. But if you were wanting to drive it to Wyoming and leave it there, then that's gonna be an added cost. So a general price for renting motorhomes, and I can't speak for, you know, where you are versus where you're going, but a general RV rental price, it depends on the size of the motorhome, but most of them start between like $70 a night to $100 a night. Now, if you're gonna go all the way to like motorhomes, that's for a travel trailer, but if you're gonna go all the way to motorhomes and like a super swanky motorhome, you could get as high as like $150 a night, but I don't imagine that you'd really even wanna go there. There are a few places to look. So you can go with companies. There's like cruiseamerica.com. But there's also some companies that allow you to rent just mom and pop motorhomes. It's like if we wanted to stick our travel trailer up there, we totally could. So the two of those, outdoorsy.com and rvshare.com, two to look at anyway. And some of those, if you are like, oh, we've never done this and this scares me, some of those are kind of neat. They'll actually give you the option to take the camper where you want to camp, and they will set it up for you. And so you just show up and you pull up into your campsite, but the camper is already there. It's already been hooked up for you, and you don't have to do any work. So that could be an option too. So in other words, if we were coming to Atlanta and we didn't own a travel trailer, but we wanted to camp, we could go through RV Share, find a camper in Atlanta. They would then bring it to the campsite, and we would technically rent it by the night. And that's actually not that expensive at all when you aren't even going to touch it. Like, I'm not going to hook it to my car. I'm not going to try to drive it anywhere, because it's less stress for the owner. I think, you know, my husband, I asked him one time, would you be willing to do this? He's like, no, because, you know, do people know how to tow it? Do they know how to back it? you're taking some risks there if it's your camper. But if you do, if you're comfortable with those things, then great. Rent it and get a really great price. So those two websites, again, outdoorsy.com and rvshare.com. It's basically like Airbnb for campers. So you get to kind of just borrow anyone that's posting their camper. You'll see the inside of it. You're not going to be shocked. You know, you'll have a full glimpse of what you're renting, but you'll get a better price than through some of the really big camper rental companies. What we did in Alaska, there are a ton of rental companies that do this out west. So if you've ever considered going and doing the Grand Canyon, doing Alaska, there are RV rental companies that entirely work in that market for people that want to come rent an RV, do out west, do it in a circle, do the Grand Canyon, etc., all your national parks in that area, and then return it where you rented it from. And you can get some really low prices on those too. Keep in mind they don't include your rent, your nightly fees in the campgrounds, but at $20 to $30 a night, that's not a big deal. So it's an option and probably cheaper than getting a hotel room, even with the added rental. And the biggest reason for that, guys, is food. So when we camp, we haven't eaten out. We've cooked every meal that we've needed. I do plan our meals pretty, like, down to the item, sometimes more so than I would at home. And we meal plan at home. But when we camp, it's down to we're eating this on night one because we're going to cook extra hamburger. So, you know, I'll go through our meals here. We came early just to kind of enjoy some vacation time. So night one, we had tacos. We double cooked our hamburger from tacos to have beef stroganoff night two with the hamburger. And then this morning, we had eggs and bacon. We cooked extra bacon to then use that to go and make a Monterey chicken, which my kids have named Amazing Chicken. So that's what we had tonight. But it's basically a copycat of Chili's Monterey chicken. So we're using things that we cooked for another meal to then make the next meal. Lunches tend to be leftovers or sandwiches, or we make a tuna pasta salad. It's kind of like an easy go-to for us. And then we'll have cereal other mornings. But meals are very planned out so that we're not having to run to the store. We just have everything we need here, and we enjoy camp life versus having to pay to eat out, pay for a hotel room. You get the idea. So it ends up being a lot cheaper. And yes, so the RV rentals, so Outdoorsy again, and RV Share are the two big ones, and we'll stick the links in for those, and for Elizabeth and Jennifer, so that you can find both of those. And in terms of price, though, Marilyn, I guess I didn't quite answer you. I'm telling you that it's there. What I will say for flying, since we're talking budget travel in general, airline tickets right now are crazy, crazy cheap. I'm not saying that you want to go in an airplane. So that really could be the reason that you want to rent a motorhome to go to Wyoming, because you'd be in your own little space, in your own little bubble, versus having to share the airplane with who knows what. You know, if you're uncomfortable with that, I don't know the airline travels where you want to go if you are uncomfortable in any way, shape, or form, but there are some crazy cheap tickets if you're not uncomfortable or you just need to go. Crazy cheap tickets. So I've shared these in the past, but website-wise, kayak.com, and kayak.com has an explore tool. So if you kind of typing it in and making sure, but I'm pretty sure, yeah, kayak.com/explore is where you want to go, and you can sit there and play. Mine knows where I am, so it went ahead and plugged in Atlanta because it can see where our internet is, but you can sit here and play with wherever you are, so it knows that I'm in this general Atlanta area, and I can get a ticket to Dallas for $32. I can go to Denver for $52, and it's just automatically showing me what my options are based on where I want to go for the cheapest tickets possible. So we could go to Jackson, Wyoming for $278, Phoenix for $60. You can also play with this is the anywhere and anytime, but I could put in a distinct month if I wanted to. So maybe I don't know where I want to go, but I want to go somewhere. We're going to go in December. We want to go somewhere in December, and I don't care where. It's going to show you all the lowest prices. We could go to Orlando for $67. We could go to Philadelphia for $49. You can also zoom out and do Europe. They're over here too with prices. I don't know that you want to go international because I don't know that anyone's going to let you in, but you could try it. So it's there. One thing to mention with air travel and even with hotels right now, so many of them are offering free changes and cancellations, and they've extended it. They had done through like June. They're just extending it through the rest of the year. So if you're kind of on the fence, you think you want to go somewhere, get the ticket and you'll have free changes. Not always getting your money fully back, but allowing you to make a change within the next year or 2 years to where you still have the full value you paid and you can use it on another ticket later. But crazy cheap tickets. So that is kayak.com/explore. And you'll be able to play, and you can put in any airport you want to leave from, anywhere you want to go. I like to leave it as anywhere in this middle column right here, because it is interesting. Like, hey, maybe I don't know where I want to go. Then I can just see what my options are. One thing to also mention on travel right now is that even our like Disney World, everybody is offering discounts right now. Universal's offering buy 2 days, get 2 days free. That are good through the end of the year. Busch Gardens offering 40% off any ticket through the end of the year. So taking advantage of these amusement parks who are trying to bring in some cash now is huge. You don't have to go right now if you're not comfortable going, but I could still get some good tickets and go in November or December if I wanted to and have a significant discount. You do want to check cancellations there, and most of them are offering the value of your ticket to be used on a future date as well. Doesn't mean that it would fully pay for it if they're not offering a discount in the future, but you know, if December rolls around and numbers are still crazy high and you don't want to go, then you switch your ticket around and you still have the cash, or you have the cash value basically of your ticket to apply to another day. But take advantage of the discounts because they're trying to increase their cash flow now. And you can get a great deal now for that trip that is months from now. I mean, it's July, and they're offering these discounts all the way through December 31st. That's pretty awesome. So, you know, wherever you want to go, whether it is to a campground or whether it's to a hotel, take advantage of the discounts that they're offering now. Think about fall break for your kids or Christmas break and try to plan around those. And by the way, guys, if your school district's looking at going virtual, welcome to homeschool, because virtual school, it isn't that bad. You can virtual school anywhere. So while school may start back, but if you aren't going back and you're going to do online school, enjoy it. Travel some during the off-peak seasons and get some good discounts and let your kids do school from the campsite. I can't count the number of times that we have done school from the campsite. So we homeschool, but our older kids do basically virtual private school for some of their classes. And as long as they have internet, they're good to go. So I did want to mention that. There are a number of websites that offer campsite reviews. So before I book any campsite, that is one thing that I look at because I need internet to share deals with you guys. They need internet to be able to do school. Thankfully, they don't have to do school during the summer, but they need internet as well. And so before I book a campsite, that's the very first thing that I do. I kind of find the campsite. I see that they have availability. And then I just Google. So for this one, Sawney is the name of the campground. Sawney campsite reviews. It will generally pull up a number of websites that are out there that offer campsite reviews. They're all free. And you can see people are sharing what their internet service was at these sites based on the phone. So we have Verizon phones, so they'll share like 4 bars or 3 bars or Verizon non-existent. And then you're like, hey, not going to that campground. Because while we can travel anywhere, it helps to be able to work while you're there. So you realize, don't book until you look at the reviews. Definitely if you're planning on working or doing school from campgrounds, that's what reviews are there for. If there are a ton of open sites, you'll also see where people have shared, oh, like this site was great, or this site was way sunny and no shade. You don't want that. So look at the reviews and get some ideas. It's just like hotels, basically. You're able to see kind of a detailed look of what these people thought about this campground. Were the bathrooms clean? You know, whatever. You may not even use the bathrooms. It's up to your system. For us with 7 people, we use the bathhouse because 7 people in one little camper, we would fill our gray and black tanks in a day and be dumping constantly. So we don't go there. But you want to look at those reviews and kind of go in wise as to what you're doing. Dabney says, what about future cruise deals? That is a great question. And so this is where we are with cruises right now. We are seeing some of them offering deals. I think for most of the big brands, they're just kind of almost at a standstill because a lot of them were planning on resuming cruises in September, and now they're back to just kind of sitting there. We're seeing some sales, but we aren't seeing anything like what we would normally see. You could totally book and play a game with that, because what some of them are doing is that once the cruise gets canceled, they're actually offering you, as long as they'll give you the chance to get your money back, but they'll also give you the chance to get all of your money plus a percentage more back than you paid for a future cruise booking. So maybe you go that route, you book a cruise that's probably going to get canceled, and then you get an increased amount of money towards a future booking. But right now, if you're going to book, I would really, I don't know, I feel like you would be playing a game and you would end up getting it canceled for any booking that is going to be potentially before even like October, November. I don't think you're going to see any of them sailing. You know, Canada is not allowing any cruises to even disembark until late September, early October. And I think you're going to see other countries follow suit. So Holland America is one line. They're not even resuming sales until January of next year. It's just, they're scared. They definitely ended up getting burned the most. And so they're scared at having that continue, that PR nightmare continue. So I don't know that I would book right now for cruises. I think I would hold off and stick to inside the United States land vacations versus water vacations. And hopefully we're going to see some really great deals on them. And Wendy's asking the same thing. Best time to book an Alaska cruise for next May. You won free tickets for a trip anywhere. That's awesome, Wendy. You can definitely look and see what the deals are that they're running. Typically, the best time that we see for cruise deals is the spring. So we're outside of the spring now. They do tend to open cruises at a 12-month rolling open. So all of the ones for next May are open. And you may want to check. I mean, I don't know. It's hard to know what the demand for cruises is going to look like next year. You know, is everybody going to be chomping at the bit because they couldn't cruise this year? Or are people going to be scared of them? And so not knowing what the demand is, that's why I'm saying it's hard to even know what the deals will be. Right now, I don't think the cruises are running a ton of huge incentives. If anything, it's maybe let's get their cash. That's what we need right now because they are just bleeding cash. And so you paying up front might be some of your best deals that you're going to see. And it might be waiting until later in the fall when they feel more stable and the whole just cruise environment feels more stable before you start to book those. But maybe we'll see some sales. Lynn, off topic, do I know if Sam's is going to have a one-day sale? Their next sale would normally be, they usually run one in August. I have not heard anything about one right now, and I kind of doubt that we're going to see one in August. So if anything, I would look for the big one that they always run the weekend of Veterans Day. I wish that we would have one before them, but I doubt it highly as we're seeing so many numbers go back up, and we're seeing a lot of towns even consider shutting things back down. I don't see them trying to pull off a before school one day sale unless they do it entirely online, which would be awesome. But so far I haven't heard a word about one. So potentially the next in-store one, which is if you're going for the cell phone deals, they're always in store, would be the weekend of Veterans Day. And that's when they always have a really huge one. Okay, so I think I'm caught up. I'm trying to catch up. Oh, Deborah, sorry, I missed yours. What's a good deal on laptops and printers? So printer-wise, Deborah, I always recommend a Brother black and white laser printer, and we can usually get it for about $75 for the wireless version. So they'll put it on sale for $99, and then we can use a coupon code to get it a little bit lower. That's how we've been playing that game in Staples. So we'll just have to wait. We have not seen it on sale yet the first 2 weeks because back-to-school deals, we're now in week two of back-to-school deals, but we should see it in the next couple weeks between Office Depot and Staples, and that's the price point that you're looking for that particular printer. There are some that are cheaper. I know Staples has a Canon Pixma color, just inkjet printer, that's basically 50% off right now. Inkjets, to me, it's like fingernails on a chalkboard. I can't handle it because of the price of replacing that ink versus getting a laser printer that is going to use toner. And laser printers are super cheap compared to inkjet printers. So no, you do not need a color printer. Yes, even if you're considering homeschooling, you do not need a color printer. So go with a black and white laser printer if you can, because long term, your savings is astronomical compared to a cheap inkjet printer now that's going to cost you an arm and a leg to get replacements for. Mm-mm, you don't want that. So that's the price point that I would look for. So about $75 for a black and white laser printer, but that Brother laser printer, the refills cost $12 and they will last you almost an entire year, like 1,500 to 2,000 pages before you need to pay another $12. So not bad at all compared to an inkjet price. And computer-wise, to talk computers, this is a tricky one because I don't know what you need. So there are three levels of PCs, basically, and we're just going to go Intel here. AMD does make Intel look-alike chips that are still great, so you figure out what you need based on the Intel numbers, and then you can look for, you know, a comparable kind of off-brand name if you want to save a little bit more. But Intel makes an i3, an i5, and an i7. An i3 is like basic. It can do, if what you're wanting is a Chromebook, you're wanting to browse the internet, you're not wanting to run a ton of programs, an i3 could be great for you. If what you're going to need to do is run more Zoom calls, run word processors, and run the internet, and maybe have some other programs going, an i3 may not cover it for you, and you need an i5. An i7 is actually pretty intense, and most of us wouldn't need i7. If you are going to do a lot of video editing, if you're, you know, things like that, graphic design work, then go i7. But most of us are going to be happy somewhere in an i3 or an i5. And that's just helping you figure out the processor that's behind your computer. Beyond that, the numbers of the memories and the hard drives, bigger numbers are great, but you're not necessarily going to store a bunch in your computer either. We've got so many places where we can store things for free now, like Google Drive, for all your documents, and you'll figure that out. But kind of figure out what you need for your computer. A good entry price for an i3 is usually $300 or less for a brand new i3. A good entry price for an i5, so again, Intel i5, this is all PCs. A good price for an i5 is about $450 or less, and you will see less. AdelleRefurbished.com, again, you can get some crazy good prices. And an i7, we're usually in the $650 and up price, because usually when you get to an i7, you're also adding in some faster video graphic cards and other things like that. So it's kind of you figuring out what it is that you want to do with your computer, and then you can kind of figure out the price ranges that you want to look for what is a good price. So that may be more than you wanted to go, but hopefully that helps a little bit. And Wendy's asking, do I foresee Black Friday looking the same this year? I do. So what I think we're going to see a lot of companies, I think so many retail companies, Wendy, are just putting, they're going to put all their eggs in their fourth quarter basket. So that is going to be October to December. We're even seeing that for Amazon. So normally, right now, would have been Amazon Prime Day. It's always this week in July. It isn't happening now. They have postponed it until October, and they've done that on purpose. One, it's to give their warehouses a little bit of a break, but really their warehouses are caught back up now. No, it's on purpose, and it's on purpose because A, they know that most of the world is kind of hurting, and so throwing in a Prime Day right now, not a lot of folks are going to buy a bunch of things that they may or may not need. But if we can throw in a Prime Day in October, it's closer to the holidays, and you totally will jump in, because come October, you can be willing to grab something as a Christmas present, or even for yourself. Like, oh, this would be a great Christmas present for myself, and they would love that. So they know people are going to be much more willing to buy come October. Prime Day is now in October. So they're kind of, most of these retailers are going into a recession mentality, and how do we convince people to spend money during a recession? We're not really there yet. I'm not saying, the R word. I'm not meaning to jinx us on anything. But most people are starting to spend that way. So many of us, we try to live that way full time, but there are a lot of folks that are jumping in now saying, you know what? Money is tight, and where can we cut, and what can we do? So not the best time for Prime Day, but come all of fourth quarter, I think you're going to see stores just throwing the sales at you, trying to bring up their sales numbers for the whole year. So don't panic. I think we're going to have a really, really fun fourth quarter when it comes to getting deals on things. You know, so for those of us who have a gift closet and we buy things all year long, maybe we can actually hold off on some things. I'm not saying, you know, skip Target toy clearance, which is going on right now. You should totally take advantage of Target toy clearance. But, you know, maybe some other things that aren't as amazing deals, you could hold off, and you're probably going to get some great deals during that whole fourth quarter, October, November, and December, and Black Friday, and get some really great prices. So advice on buying used cell phones. My son killed his in the pool. Pools and cell phones do not mix. So used cell phones, I would point you to not even necessarily used, but just looking online for unlocked phones that are good with any carrier. You're going to find some decent deals that are out there. If you want to go used, you can. You need to look at the seller, and I would actually recommend that you go local so that you know who you're buying from and you can verify that that phone fully works. Because buying used online can be tricky. You can end up getting a phone that literally has no parts on the inside. It becomes, there's a lot of scams that are running behind it. There are some good places for buying used phones. So eBay, if you're going to go that route, look at seller reviews on eBay. Look at product reviews on eBay. And eBay is definitely a buyer's market. So if the buyer says something is wrong, the seller has to give them a full credit back. You will not find used on Amazon. I would not trust Amazon for used because Amazon does not vet their third-party sellers at all. So I would go eBay. I would go Facebook Marketplace through local if you're wanting to go used. Or I would look at just some of the kind of off-brand, cheaper phones. So they don't have to have an Apple. There are a lot of great either Windows phones or Android phones that are a lot cheaper and could be new, but still a great price. Target, for example, this week has a number of their just kind of, I call them off brands because they're not brands you've heard of, but a number of their cheaper Android phones as low as like $50 in this week's Target ad. So kind of looking that route versus going with the full name brand. They're still going to be able to use all the apps they want to use. And you know what? You didn't have to pay a ton of money just to have them kill it again in another 6 months. So TVs are supposed to go real cheap, and do I know when for sure? So Rhonda, normally what we see for TVs is sales that are around when football season starts. Who knows when that's going to be? They're now saying, you know, more mid-September. I hope we have football. So it's usually that whole kind of window when football season starts, when the Super Bowl starts, which is in February, and Black Friday. So TVs are a huge one for Black Friday. So those are your three big bubbles for TVs. Outside of those, you know, maybe Sam's one day sales if you've got a Sam's card, but we don't usually see a lot of great discounts outside of those three bubbles. So if you can hold off for the rest of July and the rest of August, you'll get a much better price. Labor Day, kind of waiting for that that fall football season to start back. That's when everybody goes for that bigger TV screen and they run the big sales to go with them. Okay, let's see. I think I've caught up with everyone's questions so far. Trying to make sure, we're jumping all over the place, which I love. And Deborah, sorry, I missed your question. Oh, there we go. Deborah's saying, we stayed at campsites that had cabins to stay in, and the cabins included TVs with satellites, but no DVD players. Oh, sorry. So we usually carry a DVD player. Y'all are just sharing some tips back and forth. Sorry, I thought you had a question in there. Okay. All caught up. In regards to unlock phones, the Blue brand has a lot of really good choices. So Ari's chiming in on that one if you want to look up that particular brand. Kristen, maybe that would help you too. But check out the Target ad for sure. There's one whole page in the Target ad this week on just kind of brands that you may not have heard of that are still very, very cheap this week. So that's a fun one to look at. Okay, so for other travel things, I've made some notes just to make sure we hit it all. We hit a lot on camping. One thing I did want to mention, if you're looking at getting into tent camping or RV camping, I would highly recommend for your own sanity, this is not necessarily frugal, but for your own sanity, having your own camping stock and not raiding it. we tend to radars during the off season when we like, oh, we're out of aluminum foil. There's aluminum foil in the camper. Go get it. So if you rate it, you need to keep a note that you rated it. But even if you're a tent camper, having it in, you know, Rubbermaid bins, whatever it is, so that when you're ready to go, you really are ready to go. It's all together. I have plates. I have cups. I have, you know, my aluminum foil. I have my kitchen gear, whatever we take with us, that you have that stock. A tip for that, think used. So if you're trying to stock your camper, head to Goodwill. You'll get some crazy good deals on plates and cups. They don't have to match. They're just your camper stock. So head to Goodwill. Take advantage of 10-cent cups and 12-cent plates or whatever you can find. IKEA can also be a great place to stock your camper if you want to go newer. But same for tents. Having your own gear, it's already ready to go to where literally you just slide the Rubbermaid totes in the car. You're done. And camping feels easier. It feels more doable because I don't have to sit there and constantly go through this list of what do I need to pack to go on a tent trip or an RV trip. It's already set aside. And it makes it where you tend to go more often, but you can find deals on those things too. So again, Goodwill, IKEA, you know, you can grab some deals on Amazon or Kohl's, even when Kohl's is running a 30% off, getting a super cheap set of silverware. I will confess that a lot of times we use paper and plastic because I don't love washing dishes on campouts, but having that in, you know, a go bin, a Foot Locker, we've seen deals even with Foot Lockers on Walmart. We actually grabbed one that I posted earlier this summer. It was like a $16 Foot Locker with rollers that becomes your stash. So this whole stash is the kitchen. Organize it too, just to make your life easier. So you have a bin that is just kitchen. You have a bin that is just towels and sheets, etc. So that when you're getting to camp, you're not like, this is all thrown together. You won't need a ton, but you will quickly figure out what you need and what you don't need. So for us, camping wise, we have it all set to go. Also, a little tip, if you have an older camper, turn, you can buy dry erase board that's really, really cheap. And so we actually turned our refrigerator panels, so think old refrigerator, we turned our panels into a dry erase board in the camper. And so that is my go-to. When I run out of something, it just gets written on the freezer door, which is a dry erase board, of what I need to bring into the camper for the next trip. Because when you get home and you've tried to make that mental list, don't always remember your mental list, but now it is on the freezer door of the camper, just getting some cheap dry erase board and flipping that panel around, cutting it to the exact same size as the little panel so it matches in there. We also turned our fridge panel over and used some chalkboard paint and turned our fridge bottom, because it's, you know, top freezer and bottom fridge into a chalkboard. So you can have some fun with it if you wanted to both ways. That was just kind of one little project that we did. But I love having a dry erase board right there on the freezer so that I can keep track of what we're out of, what needs to be replaced before we go on the next trip. So it doesn't feel like every time you're like, we're still missing this, or getting home and having to rack your brain of what did we say that we needed to get? It's done. You wrote it down. Makes it kind of easy and fun as well. So let's see. Okay, so I think we've hit a lot of things that I had. If you're wanting to travel that is not camping, again, you can get some crazy good discounts on amusement parks right now. So look at Busch Gardens, look at Universal. Universal's deals are running through the end of July. It's buy 2 days and get 2 days for free. And also, don't pass up VRBO and Airbnb. I have a sweet friend who has Airbnb up in Boone, and I know for her Airbnb is normally like half of her income, and it's just gone. But those are still there, and you can get some really good deals on Airbnbs and VRBOs through the rest of the year. They're still available for you to be able to go and have a night away without kids, if that's how you wanted to do it, and get some pretty good prices. It's also a great way to help some people out. So look for the ones that are just owned by mom and pop brands, not necessarily the ones that are run by, you know, rental agencies, but just the mom and pops that are Airbnb-wise. They will even say, like, that they're a five-star location or five-star renter, so that you've got, you know, a great place to work through, but you're going to help them out because they could love some income too. Their income's been slashed, but you're going to get a great deal to stay with them. I know I've been talking camping because that's what we're doing. The crickets are all coming out. I don't know if you can hear all the noises, campground noises behind me, but, you know, look for other ways to save, not necessarily hotels right now, but going local and helping out the local guy, and you're going to get some deals to do that too. And then also thinking about the fact that refunds are available for so many places. So if COVID numbers go back up or you get sick and you can't travel, those are all possibilities. One thing to mention in that, travel insurance. You need to look at the fine print before you purchase any travel insurance, because a lot of travel insurances do not include COVID. So unless they've added those policies or they clearly state that it does now, that isn't going to get you covered. It's really going to be what the policy is for, like the amusement park or the airline, but it isn't going to be a general travel insurance policy that's going to handle it. Rhonda's saying, turn your car into campers. We totally could do that. Not, maybe not for us. That would be seven people and very tight. But the person that is across the way from of us right now is in a van that's been modified, definitely. Am I going to do a Walgreens video this week, Susanna? I am. It's going to be like I did last week, though. So I'm going to do the pictures and talk you through all the deals. And Walgreens this week, remember, all those deals you can get online, so makes it even better. But that's what we're going to do. It'll be tomorrow. So I'll do that late tomorrow afternoon, all of the Walgreens pictures and deals that you can grab in the store. And I know how long CVS will continue to do the everyday app freebies? It's running through the 18th. So that is this coming Saturday. There is everyday freebies running at CVS. So you should take full advantage of those for now. And Don's asking, do we have a favorite state park for camping? That is really tricky, Don. We've had a number of fun campsites that we've absolutely loved. And I think every single one of my kids would say a different place. And it's probably just because of the things that we've done. Some of our favorites, we love FDR State Park that is outside of like Callaway Gardens, because we love Callaway Gardens. So that's south of Atlanta. We love Lake Oconee, which is in South Carolina. And Hunting Island, which is a beach South Carolina State Park, and it's down by Beaufort, and then keep on going out into the middle of nowhere. Probably those would be our top three family state parks. This one's very nice, not knocking Sawney either, but those are probably our top three just based on just the fun things that we also did while we were there as a family. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and call us there, guys. It's been fun chatting, camping, and savings. We're going to talk all back to school next week and just ways to save on back to school, how to even plan if you don't even know what back to school is going to look like. That's the plan for next week's Q&A. So if you are ready for back to school or not, jump in and let's talk about just saving money and the deals that we're going to see and how to plan. So thanks for joining me tonight. I'll be back on tomorrow with drugstore deals. I don't know when. It's whenever we get home, but tomorrow afternoon. So you guys have a great evening, and hopefully I'll talk to you again soon.